places, we'll start our service if you'd like to stand and join us in our worship.
Victory in the end. Friday. It's a great day. Even my footy team won on yesterday, so that's even better. But no, it's good to be worshipping here. Much more important things than footy going on. A few things to bring to your attention. Craft group is on in the hall this Wednesday, 9:30 a.m. Cuppa and Care is still in recess. And that's mainly because starting from this Wednesday, we're holding some Living Out Our Faith training workshops. And that's going to be this Wednesday the 17th, next Wednesday the 24th, a session at 10 a.m. and a session at 7 p.m. on both days. 10 a.m. one's sort of a bit not quite there at the moment. If you want to be attend the 10 a.m. session, can you please sign up today in the foyer and make sure we have enough people to keep that one going. But both of those weeks, two Wednesdays, Living Our Faith training sessions. It'd really be helpful for you. Make the time to attend if you can. Next Sunday will be a emphasis on children in that service. In the second service, there's going to be something which I've forgotten now, but there'll be something. I know Turtle's playing for a start. But after that, there'll be a family lunch. This is 21st, next Sunday. Family lunch after the service at about 11:45. So again, if you can put your name down on the sheet in the foyer if you wish to attend, so that we can bring you some food to eat, not that we're ever likely to run out. Barrister training. Oh, what have you, Barrister Kelly? Actually, it's barista. It's barista. Got you all excited to have a church full of barristers. No, it's barista training. If you'd like to learn how to make coffee, that will be held sometime by Lyndon, and so be part of that if you can. And just keep in mind, long time, well, actually, but it'll come very quickly. The women's retreat in August, that's coming up. Now, all of that stuff and more is in the Life and Times, which you can get today, comes out Monday as well. And just keep up with what's going on in the church community and be a part of it as you can do that. Let's join together with a time of prayer. Father God, we come to you this morning mindful that there's probably more than once during this week we've fallen short of the standards you have for us, of the plan you have. We might have strayed off the path once or twice or even more, but we know that today we're just welcome. You welcome us into your presence to worship you. Whatever we've done, wherever we are, whether we're near to you or perhaps a little further away, you welcome us into your presence and you look forward to our worship with you. Today there are people who can't be here because of illness, people who are just not here for other reasons. Be with those if they're watching online. May they be blessed by this time. Those who are ill, be with them as well. Today it's about, we're still looking at, maybe we have some doubts about the resurrection as we read about it. And I pray that today any doubts we might have will be gone, that we'll be fully convinced that you died for us willingly and yet you conquered death so that we might live with you forever. Today I pray that we'll give ourselves to you completely in worship, that other things we'll just leave for this time and we'll return to them later, encouraged by you, filled with your spirit again and again, so that we can be encouraged through this coming week to shine your light, encourage others, and just to know that you are with us at all times, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Roger. We're going to sing another song, and then straight after that, we're going to have a special talk / interview, I'm not really sure yet, from Peter McSween. So you can get excited for that, but first we're going to sing God of Wonders, if you'd like to stand and join us.
Creation. about to have Peter McSween come and join us up on the stage. Now, Peter is part of a group that we support as a church called MAF, which is Mission Aviation Fellowship. It's a mission that we support where they fly into the remotest communities of the world to not only just to give supplies, to give medical equipment, food and so forth, but to also take in faith with them. So they bring in Bibles, they tell stories about Jesus, and they teach a little bit about how what Jesus has done in their life to those different communities where they fly into. Now, Peter, he did call himself a little bit crazy this morning, so I'm going to invite Peter to come up and to explain why he perhaps has got this title of being called a little bit crazy, because it's pretty impressive. Anyway, I'll leave that up to Peter.
Thanks, Evan, and good morning. Well, I didn't call myself crazy at all. It was somebody else who called me crazy. I've been the Central Queensland advocate for Mission Aviation Fellowship now for about 9 years. And as such, I've been reasonably close to the activities, particularly in this part of the world, with what MAF is doing to bring the gospel to people in remote places. But in 2021, 3 years ago, I received a letter from the then CEO of Mission Aviation Fellowship, Ian McDonald. And I'd just like to read you a few little excerpts from his letter, because this has got a lot to do with why we're doing what we're doing. He says, "Dear Peter, I recently came across this quote from Jim Elliot. The will of God is always a bigger thing than we bargain for, but whatever it involves, it is good. I'm sure you can testify to this too. God often calls us this way, out of our comfort zones, to achieve his good purposes in this world. The last 75 years of MAF are filled with story upon story of God calling the MAF family to stretch and grow so that more isolated communities would experience his love. And each and every big step has been met with his faithfulness. In 2003, one of those big steps was taken when the maintenance base moved from Ballarat to Mareeba, and it had been in Ballarat since 1961, so it was a big move. Moving 2,800 kilometres north was no small move, but it would mean that aircraft coming off the mission field would save 2 days of travel on either side of their maintenance. The cumulative effect of this efficiency would lead to more people being reached. And so, a temporary hangar was privately leased at Mareeba Aerodrome to help the team get started. It wasn't an ideal space, but it would do until something more permanent was found." He goes on to say, "Over the past 2 years, a number of things have come together which have helped us quite clearly see where God is leading us." Now remember, this was 3 years ago. "Firstly, an incredible 12 acres of land situated right next to the airport came up for sale. At the same time, the current private lease that we had held for 18 years is expiring at the end of this year, and renewing it is no longer an option. This new property gives us an exciting long-term vision. It will allow us to create an MAF hub that would incorporate the MAF flight school, an engineering school, accommodation, and an aviation department. But before any of this, we must make the first step in building the new hangar, or hangars as it turned out. This project is estimated to cost around $3 million. It will set us up for decades to come, drastically improving our ability to service aircraft efficiently, train new engineers, and lower our operating costs. Ultimately, it will help us reach more isolated communities with the help they need. God spoke to me after I read that letter. And he said, you have a duty to go and do something about this. I'd been flying for over 50 years now, and I'd flown all sorts of aircraft. But a thought came to me that if we're going to do something for an aviation organisation, we should do something that is aviation-oriented. Makes sense, doesn't it? And I thought, I could get in a little aeroplane, and I could fly all around Australia and bring the message of MAF to everybody, but they'd see me coming and see me go. Not very spectacular at all. So I decided that we should do something a little more enduring, something that was slow and people could see and marvel at and enjoy. So I hatched a plan to fly a powered parachute around Australia. Now, I don't know if many of you have ever seen a powered parachute or know what a powered parachute is. But if you can imagine a go-kart, I'm sure we all know what a go-kart is. It's like a go-kart that's got a big propeller on the back of it. And it has a parachute on top, which is used as a wing. And believe it or not, it flies. Now, I'd never flown one of these before. I've flown everything else. So we had to get a powered parachute. But before this happened, later that year in 2021, after Ian had written me this letter, I was in Sydney, and I thought I'd better go and tell the CEO of MAF what's going on and give him an idea of what our plans are. Well, I did, and I explained it all to Ian, just as I've mentioned it here now, and he looked at me sternly, and he lowered his glasses, and with a very gloomy, solemn look, he just said, "You're a crazy man." Well, as it turned out, I might be. But there's 12 other crazy people too who are joining me on this mission, because I can't do it alone. And if we have a team that God will honour and we can do it in his name, we can do what Ian's requesting us to do for MAF. Hopefully, we're going to take off on the 1st of June this year, and we're going to be away for 6 to 8 weeks just spreading the good news of the gospel of Christ to people all around Queensland. Well, we went to Melbourne. Keith Mansfield, our campaign director, and I set off, and we bought a powered parachute. And we towed it all the way back to Bundaberg. And I've been learning to fly this thing for the last 2 months or so, and it should all finish this week, one way or the other. But we'll be ready for the 1st of June. We're going to fly from Bundaberg, starting on the 1st of June. We're going to fly all the way up the coast, across to Corumba, and then down through the western interior to Cloncurry, Barcaldine, Blackall, Tambo, wending our way down to Augathella and Charleville, and then across east to Toowoomba, across to Surfers Paradise, and up the coast home. Hopefully, this is going to give us the opportunity to spread the word of what we're trying to do. Now, these things don't go very fast, so, you know, it'll give everybody ample time to have a look at it. The needs of MAF are many and varied, but this particular issue touched me. And, I mean, we're talking about money here. But it's not just money, it's money to achieve a purpose. And that purpose is to pay for the hangars. And paying for the hangars alleviates the burden of finance. And it will then allow us to put that money into other areas and be able to bring the gospel to people in isolated areas. So, some of the needs at the moment are probably as great or greater than this need. However, this is what we're commissioned to do, and this is what we've committed ourselves to do. Currently in Papua New Guinea, there is a fuel crisis, an aviation fuel crisis. We were paying $350 for a 200-litre barrel of aviation fuel. Supplies dwindled, it was unavailable, and we've had to source supplies from New Zealand. We're currently importing 500 barrels of aviation fuel a month into PNG, and that's costing us $1,000 a barrel. So there's a very dire need there. In South Sudan, where we operate, there's been a war going on for 30 years. One of our pilots was captured and he was committed to jail for a period of time, fortunately, and thank our God, and through much prayer, he was released and he's now back flying again. In Timor-Leste, there is a need. The one and only fixed wing operator who was there taking children to school and delivering pigs to market and all sorts of vegetables and other things has left the country. And now MAF is committed to taking children to school, because you can't just get on a horse or walk to school when you're in remote places of the world. So MAF is taking kids to school in the morning, picking them up and bringing them home in the afternoon. And of course, there's the perennial and always present staff shortages all around the world for pilots, engineers, maintenance people, managers, country directors, and so the list goes on. It all costs money. But there are two things that I'd like to just stress that we're looking for. I envisage the day very soon when we can fly into an outback town and there might be a dozen or 20 or 30 children from a country school seeing this old man flying this go-kart in the air come in and land. They might remember that, but as we go, we're taking with us the gospel of Christ. We have a full-time chaplain who's accompanying us, and we're not just flying an odd aircraft around the place. We're bringing the word of God to these people. And I hope that when that little kid grows up and he's 50 or 60 or 70 or 80 years of age, he'll remember the day the gospel came to his town. So we're very much looking forward to that. But there are two things, if I could ask you to accompany us with. The first thing is prayer. Nothing happens in God's service without a conversation with him. We need to talk to him. And I can assure you that all our team and the church, and other churches too for that matter, have been very active in praying for our safety, for the work of MAF, that the funds will be achieved, and that the work of MAF can continue. So if you would pray, we'd be very appreciative. Somebody once said, MAF is like a big kite. Interesting analogy. Well, a kite doesn't fly without wind. And prayer is the wind that keeps the kite afloat. So if you could remember that, we need prayer, first thing. And finally, if you could remember us by giving, we need to achieve $30,000 as our target that we're hoping to raise by doing this. And if you're in any way able to support us, and the church has certainly already, but individually, if you'd like to support the work of MAF, we have a donation box in the foyer. Or if you see somebody with a red shirt on here this morning, you can talk to any one of us. And not some of us have red shirts. That's okay. But we need to raise funds. And we're just asking that you might support us in that respect, and that we can bring to MAF the wherewithal that will allow them to continue their good work and bring the gospel to the ears of people who perhaps have never ever heard the name of Jesus. Thank you.
Thank you, Peter. We're going to sing one more song, and then Jeff is going to come up and bring us the communion. If you'd like to stand and join us.
Sorry about that. I have to give mention to Bruce Green this morning because he inspired what I'm about to say. At the men's breakfast that we had a couple of weeks ago, we sat at the same table and we compared and shared our stories. This morning I want to talk about scars. And scars tell a story of an event that happened in our life. And I'm sure most of you here bear some sort of scar. The event might have been an accident or a deliberate act that caused the scar. It could have been self-inflicted or at the hands of someone else. But all scars serve as a reminder. A reminder to cast our minds back to something or to someone significant. 18 years ago, I underwent spinal surgery, and of course it left a scar. I still endure discomfort and I'll always be on pain medication to manage my discomfort. But every once in a while my back will grab me and just remind me of what I've been through. And when it does, it's an automatic reaction to grab my back. And as I do that, I can feel the scar. That scar that the surgeon left serves as a reminder to me of where I was once before the surgery. And it also serves as a reminder of where I could have been if I didn't have the surgery. After the resurrection of Jesus Christ, there's a disciple by the name of Thomas. And he was able to put his hands into the wounds of Jesus. Thomas would have felt the scars. Jesus, after his crucifixion, still bore the scars. And I want to read you a verse in Revelation which you may or may not have come across. In Revelation chapter 5, we read these words. And John, when he got this revelation, he was told to write down everything he saw and heard. And so he wrote this down. He says, I saw a lamb as it had been slain. I saw a lamb as it had been slain. Those words echo in my mind that maybe, just maybe, he still bears the scars. Maybe he'll bear those scars forever. Maybe it'll serve as a reminder for us of just how much he loves us. In the Gospel of Luke, chapter 22, Luke records these words. He says, he took the bread and he gave thanks and he broke it and gave it to them saying, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. This morning, as you receive the elements, I want you to take time to think about and to contemplate and to meditate on just how much it cost to have your sins forgiven. His scars that he bears may just be a constant reminder for you of just how deep his love is for you. Can the attendants come forward? by his wounds we are healed. As you take the cup, just hold it until everyone receives and we can all drink together. When Jesus took the cup, he said, "This is my blood, which is poured out for you for the forgiveness of sin." Let us drink and remember and be thankful. You can just leave the cups on the chairs beside you or on the floor, and they'll be collected after the service. We can never repay the debt that we owe. It cost him everything. And we now come to the part of the service where we are able to give back to him as recognition of what he gave for us. And if you came prepared to give to the work of the Lord, there's a box in the foyer which you can place your gift. And if you give online, thank you. We're just going to give thanks now for the gifts that we bring. Father, we are so grateful and we are so thankful for the price you paid. We'll always be ever in your debt because our sins are forgiven, something that we can't do on our own, something that you did for us. We can't add to it. We can't take away from it. You did it all on the cross. And we ask now that your Spirit will move those who are responsible for the distribution of your gifts to extend your kingdom so that others may know and come to the knowledge of how deep your love is for them. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The Bible reading this morning is from Matthew chapter 28. Matthew chapter 28, starting at verse 16. It says, "Then the 11 disciples went to the Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. And when they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. And then Jesus came to them and said, 'All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always, to the very end of the age.'"
Thank you to the team leading us today. Some good songs there that we got to hear, so thank you for that. Now, this big hello to those watching online too. I forgot to say that before, so sorry. But yes, glad that you can be joining with us today as well. Now, this week's a bit of a big week. Some stuff's happening this week. What's happening, kids? Back to school, isn't it, tomorrow? Exciting, isn't it? Some of the parents might be going, yeah. But also, that also means school staff are back tomorrow as well. So teacher aides, teachers, back at school as well, school chappies. So please keep all those people in your prayers as they go back to school. And because of that, it also means that our kids programs are starting back. Our youth and kids programs are starting back this week as well. So youth group and mainly music start back this week. And then also Wednesday, we've got our workshop starting, as Roger mentioned before. But today ends this what's been a bit of a short series on the doubts of the resurrection. Now, I hope over this past week you've been able to unpack some of the doubts that you have had, or perhaps some of the doubts you have at the moment. And I hope that you've been able to share them with someone, have a chat and talk them over with someone. As I mentioned last week, having doubts and having questions isn't necessarily a bad thing. Sometimes we can view it as, oh, that means we're bad. No, it actually, I see it as an invitation for us to grow closer to Jesus as we search to find the answers. Now, over this past week, I've been trying to do some maths, which has been a little bit difficult. The reason why it's difficult is I've been trying to do some maths of how long that I've been leading youth ministry for. And so I was trying to work out the exact date. It's been a little bit. So it's been about 20 years or so, give or take a few years around that. So 20 years been leading youth ministry, which is quite a long time if you think about it. But over that time, when it comes to the question of faith, when I've had youth in front of me and I asked them to think about it, and I've asked them about, you know, are you a follower of Jesus? You know, where are you sitting with following Jesus? Most of the answer is a little bit like this. A bit 50-50. You know, they said, you know, if there was a fence, I'd be sitting on it because, you know, I've got 1 foot each side. If there was a pool, I'd have one leg in, one leg out. This is the sort of answers that they would answer with. Part of that is, you know, that they want to commit to some parts of what Jesus says, but then also they still want to live perhaps their own way as well. Of course, we all know that there isn't such thing as a fence to sit on when it comes to following Jesus. Jesus doesn't want people to be half-hearted in their approach in following him. He wants to see people that are all in, that are denying themselves and following him. In the end, to sit on a fence means that we've actually sort of made a decision already. It actually means that we're not going to follow Jesus just yet. Now, as I've told the youth, you actually need to make a decision one way or the other. There'll come a day when you're going to have to choose to decide to follow him or not to. But you can't just keep hanging out on a fence, because the only person you're going to be fooling is yourself. Doubts is one of the big reasons that people sit on the fence, particularly doubts of the resurrections, doubts over the life of Jesus and what he did. Is it real, or is it just a con job that people have made up and people have been keep going and going and going? Now, as we looked last week, we saw there are ways in which we can see and experience Jesus today to help turn that doubt into faith. But ultimately, we have to make a choice. Am I going to be a follower of Jesus? Yes or no, or not yet? Today, we're going to be looking at another particular scene after the resurrection of Jesus where there are some of Jesus' disciples doubting who they were seeing before them. Now, this particular scene is not famous for the doubt of the disciples, but for the commissioning of the disciples to go into all the world and be disciples. Is that what Jesus said? No, what did he say? He had to go into the world and make disciples, right? We're not supposed to be being disciples in the world. We're supposed to actually go and make disciples in the world. And we're going to talk about more about that starting next week. But before the commissioning of the disciples, we read in a line about the mood of the people that were there. Then the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. When they saw him, they worshipped him. But some doubted. Now, these lines can cause us to ask the question, who is it here that is doubting? Who is it? Who isn't doubting? Is it some of the 11 that are doubting? Remember, it's only 11 now, as Judas is now, you know, he's passed on. But as I see it, I don't actually think the 11 disciples would be doubting. they'd already seen Jesus, spent time with him 2 to 3 times by now. And I think that the women, when they were told, you know, by the angel, remember on Easter, you go back to Easter morning when we talked about the angel told that the angel told the women to go and tell the brothers to meet him in Galilee. Many scholars think that the angel was referring to the wider group of followers, not just the 11 disciples. It's actually Jesus met them several times in Jerusalem before they left for Galilee to meet him on this mountain. So the thought is that the ones who there were doubting were the ones that were in fact the part of the wider group of the followers of Jesus. Which according to Paul, in his first letter to the community in Corinth, Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians 15:6, after that he appeared, meaning he, Jesus, he appeared to more than 500 of the brothers and sisters at the same time. Most whom are still living, though some have fallen asleep. And obviously we know falling asleep means they've passed on. So according to Paul, there were more than 500 people there that day that saw Jesus on that mountain. Also think that it is great that Paul gets this information of this resurrection appearance, not from other things, but actually from people who were actually there. There's some that are there are still alive. So he's actually got that information. He's been able to write that down and pass it on. So I see that that the people there that were there were the ones, that big group of people, 500 people, were the ones that some of them were doubting about who they were seeing before him. Because we remember that the 11 disciples, that they'd already seen Jesus, and there was something else that happened in that scene. And what was that scene? When they saw Jesus, they worshipped him. They worshipped him and as Jesus, and as worshipped him as Lord. But they were gathered there with those 500 that haven't seen Jesus risen yet. That was perhaps their first time. I'm sure that some of the disciples that actually came that day were probably wondering, you know, I'm wondering if what those women said is actually true. Were they telling the truth when they said, you know, Jesus is alive and an angel told them? Maybe they turned up just to see what the women had said. Perhaps that, you know, that the word had got around. The disciples had started talking, word of mouth, you know, stories get spread pretty quick. And so perhaps they heard about Jesus appearing to these disciples. And so they were going, well, I'm going to come and have a look too. So there would have been some people there that would have been expecting perhaps seeing Jesus alive because they've heard the stories. They were expecting to see Jesus. Perhaps there were some there that were a little bit pessimistic. You know, I don't quite believe this. I'm going to see for myself. So we see that there was a whole lot of people there probably thinking a few different things. They wanted to see if Jesus had indeed risen. And then, as we see, it causes those, when Jesus appears, it causes those, some there, to start worshipping him. I reckon it would have started off with the 11 disciples, because, you know, they've already seen Jesus. Some of them actually ate with him, spent time eating with him. So I reckon as soon as they saw Jesus, they would have been the ones that first started to bow down and just to worship him as Lord. And then I think as others sort of seen their reaction, that they would have... And they saw Jesus, they would have went, yeah, you know, Jesus is alive. And they would have joined in. But the text says that even amongst that, there was some were doubting. They had heard the stories of Jesus' resurrection from the others. They had now seen the resurrected Jesus with their very eyes as those around them had come and worshipped Jesus as their Lord. They'd come into the presence of God. But still they were struggling with their belief. As I said last week, for those that were there, they probably had not seen anyone come alive again after they had been dead, particularly dead and in a tomb for 3 days. They hadn't seen anyone come back from that. You know, that's normally, it's over. So for them, they were struggling with what they were seeing before them and what they had actually experienced in their lives for themselves. They're trying to come to terms with it. But ultimately, they're going to have to actually make a choice. They had to make a choice of whether or not they were going to believe in the resurrected Jesus. They, unlike Thomas, even though they had seen, they did not believe straight away. They were still deciding if this is the Jesus they saw crucified. If this was the Jesus they called Messiah. Or perhaps was this just the figment of their imagination? They had to decide whether or not their friends around them had perhaps been just caught up in the hysteria of bowing down to Jesus, or whether or not they saw something that they were missing. There was a choice to be made. Do you know, we're not actually told about what happened to those disciples that were doubting there that day. We're not told if they ended up believing or not. You know, I imagine that some would have said, yes, I believe. And that perhaps there would have been some there that said, you know, this is all just too much. I'm actually walking away. But what we do know, from this moment on, a great movement started, and the world has never been the same since. All of us here at some point have or will have to make a decision on what we think is true. We cannot just sit on a fence wanting a foot in both camps because, you know, there are some things that we can't understand, or there's some things that just seem too impossible for us because we've never experienced them in our own lives. And while I believe we can still seek and see Jesus and see him and experience his presence, we'll never fully believe in him unless we decide to get off the fence and to start following him. You know, with me faced with this evidence that's recorded in the Bible and in the lives of those who had followed Jesus, and even within my own experience of Jesus, I have come to know, just like Thomas said last week, Jesus is my Lord and my God. But what about you? Have you come to know Jesus as your Lord and your God? If you haven't and you're still sort of thinking that you're sitting on the fence, don't sit on the fence. A fence is a really uncomfortable thing to sit on for a really long time. You don't want to be there too long. Decide today if you want to believe in the resurrected Jesus and come and worship him. Do you know, all of us are here today because of those that were there on that mountain that day. Over 500 people saw Jesus alive. Because they saw that Jesus was alive, and with the commandment of loving God and loving people, with the commission of going into all the world and telling people about the resurrected Savior, teaching them the things that Jesus taught them, baptizing them, the message of the resurrection of Jesus has been passed on to generation to generation until we're here today. We have Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, who were so inspired by what they experienced of Jesus or what they saw of Jesus, they decide not just to let the life of Jesus get passed on through word of mouth, but they wrote it down so that others could know the truth of Jesus and what he taught. Did you know the only reason why we have our Bible today is because people put their lives on the line to protect it? Because there was a time, particularly towards the end of the first century, in the first century, that Christianity was outlawed. You know, that they wanted to kill all Christians, and they did. They wanted to grab every literature and burn it, and they did burn some. But people risked their lives and put their lives on the line to protect the Gospels, to protect the writings that we have today, so that it could be passed on, because that's how important these words that of Jesus, these letters of Paul, were so important. They wanted them to be preserved. We sit here today with these writings, with these accounts of Jesus, the accounts of people that even though had seen Jesus alive, there were still doubts. I think that's an amazing thing. You know, they didn't sugarcoat anything. They didn't write, oh, and they all believed. They're real stories about real people, about real emotions. You know what? People doubted. They didn't say it. You didn't come and say, oh, then they all believe. No, we don't know. They're real accounts of what people saw and felt. So of all this in mind, we have to decide for ourselves what we believe. We've got the evidence before us. We can have the experience of Jesus in our life. What is it we're going to believe? For those of us that can say Jesus is our Lord and our God, did you know we're not supposed to be idle in our faith? We're not supposed to sit on the fence in our faith about what we should do. We've actually been given a job. Jesus gathered all the disciples on the mountain that day to give them a special job, a special message. And that was to go into all the world and tell others about Jesus and teaching them the things that Jesus taught them and to baptize them. And this is our charge as we go out every single day into the world that we've been called out into to go to. We too get to invite those around us to come and see the resurrected Savior, to come and experience the risen Savior in their life, and to come and follow Him. And over these next 3 weeks, we're going to be looking at how we can go about that. And that's also what our workshops are about. So please, if you haven't registered yet, put your name down. Because how do we go about making disciples, going into all the world? That's the commandment we've been given. How do we do it? Let's not sit on the fence about that one. But can I say today, if you haven't yet made up your mind about believing in Jesus, if perhaps you see yourself sitting on a fence, having 1 foot in the pool, I invite you today to look at the evidence and decide for yourself if Jesus is your Lord and your God. And today, if you want to make that decision, if you want to get serious, if you want to come off that fence, I invite you to come and tell a trusted Christian friend or come and tell me. Because there's nothing more that we'd love to see as a church community than people coming to know Jesus as their Lord and Savior. Now, I've got a couple of questions this week for you to ponder on. I think most life groups also start back. Firstly, where are you sitting on the fence? We often sit on fences about lots of things. It's not necessarily faith. It can be what we do once we have faith. You know, whether or not I should be making disciples, we can sit on the fence about that. We can sit on the fence about different relationships. We can sit on the fence about all sorts of things. So where are you sitting on the fence today? And secondly, will you commit to following Jesus today? You know, sometimes as believers, we can say we believe, but we know within ourselves that we're perhaps not that committed, you know. We say the right things, we know the right things to say, but in our own heart, we know we're not that committed. So maybe, will you commit to following Jesus today is a recommitment, a new desire to go and follow Jesus and do what He commands. Let me just close in prayer. I'll invite the team to come back as we close out the service today. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, I just give You thanks. I give You thanks for all the brave men and women who have gone before us, who have protected Your word over all these years so that we may be reading it today, reading the truth that is in it, so that we may come and believe ourselves. Father, I pray for those who have doubts, those who are still sitting on the fence, Lord, that today You may give them the boldness and the courage to make a decision to follow You. Father, I pray that then You may give them the boldness and courage to then tell someone about it, tell someone of the decision they made. And Father, I pray for us that know You as our Lord and Savior, Lord, that we do not just take it as for granted, Lord. That, Father, we will seriously look at our commitment to following You and doing what You have commanded us to do. Father, we give You thanks. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, when the 500 disciples were there up on that mountain, Jesus, they worshipped Him as their Lord and Savior. We need to do that right now. To worship Jesus as our Lord and Savior. Let's do that. you for all you've done. What great words. We're about to go out into the week that God's given us and go into those places where God is sending us. Let us go and let us pray before we go. Father, we just give you thanks that we get to come here this morning and gather together, worship you, to hear from your word, to be challenged and be encouraged from it. Father, as we go now, we just ask that your hand will just be upon us, that as we go out into those places where you're sending us to the people around us, that, Father, we see with your eyes and your ears where you're working around us so that we may join you there, that we may tell others of the wonderful news of you. Father, we just ask that you go with us now. In Jesus' name, amen. Don't forget to talk to the MAF team. They'd love to speak with you this morning.